Put your hands together now. We want to sing this song, which is a testimony of how good God's been to us. Amen. After 2020 and all we've been doing, come on, we can testify that God's been good to us. Amen. Well, I got a happy soul. I've got goodness untold. I've got another day. I've got a lot to say. He's been good.
He's been good.
Yeah.
He's been good.
He's been good. Put your hands together. Yeah. Sublime. I've got my own right mind. I've got a light to shine. He's my.
He's been good.
Can I get a witness? He's been good.
He's been good.
Yeah, he's been good.
He's been good.
He's been good.
He's been good.
Come on. Hey. Hey.
Hey,
yes sir. Hey.
Hey,
listen to this. Whoa, can I get a witness? Can I hear from you? Can I get a witness? Can I hear from you? You say.
Can I get a witness? Can I hear from you?
Hey.
Hey.
Jesus, because he's a good God. I said he's a good God. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God.
Hallelujah to God, be the glory to God, be the glory. Well, God has allowed us to come to another Wednesday, and so that is cause for us to give God praise, because it's not that we've been so good, but only because God has been good to us. And I trust that somewhere along your day, you've taken God, taking time out just to tell God thank you for his safekeeping. Come on, let us pray. Father, we love you, God. We thank you now for all things, God. We thank you for this time. We thank you for the space that we occupy. And so now, God, as we come in now to this time of study, God, as we study your word and as we also deal with practical principles to help us in life, we pray, God, that this will be an encounter, God, with your glory that will shape us, God, and shift us, God, and place us on the road to recovery. So, God, move us out of the way that your spirit can have free course now. Speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, God bless you. God bless you. Happy Wednesday to you. Pray that the fasting is going well. I want to encourage your heart for you to stay in the race. Stay in the race, God. Has great things in store for you. God is well pleased with your efforts. God knows how difficult it is for you, how tough it is for you, how you've been enduring the process, and God is well pleased, and you should be pleased with yourself. And some of you who may have fallen off, but if you've fallen off, come on, get you, dust yourself off and get back in the race. Hallelujah. And there's some of you that did not start with us, but even though you didn't start with us, you can catch up with us, and you can just get right in and you can get it going with us. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Well, we're on chapter 3. We have been studying this book. I pray that it's been a blessing to you and been transformative to you, but it's certainly been a blessing to me. Atomic Habits by James Clear. And what we've done affectionately for our church body and our church family, we started the 1% Club. And the 1% Club, to be a part of that, if you're a member of our church, if you're connected to our church in any kind of way, you are officially an honorary member of the 1% Club, because the 1% Club is that you vow to get 1% better every day in every area of your life. I'm a 1%er, 1%, part of that 1% Club. I'm getting 1% better in every area of my life every day. Because according to James Clear, this particular book, that if we get 1% better in every area of our life, and at the end of a calendar year, we're 37 times better. Now, if you times that times 2, you know where you are. If you times that times 3, you know where you are. And then at that point, you begin to get to a place where you can leave a legacy. Hallelujah. You can leave a legacy for your children and those that are connected to you. So we're going to get into this lesson on today. And the key knowledge pointers for this particular lesson are habits create freedom and how to create a good habit. We're going to show how habits create freedom, and then we're going to talk about how to create a good habit. Very quickly, as we pierce this particular lesson, I want to take a moment or two by way of scripture to bring us into this study, to center our focus around this. While traditionally for our Bible study, we're coming strictly from the Bible, but now we're supplementing and we're adding something. But the premise of this whole thing is that we need to get better in every area of our life, that there is an exact correlation between our ways and our habits. And in fact, our habits are our ways, and our ways are come out of our habits. And so when we deal with our ways and we deal with our habits, we ultimately will become better. And so to that end, somebody that you are in your situation in your life, it's not so much that you have a money problem, but you have a habit problem. It's not so much that you can't function in relationships or function on jobs or et cetera, et cetera. It's a habit problem. And so what we're discovering is when we fix those habits, which are ultimately our ways, then ultimately it will bring better solutions as well as situations in and to our life. I want to lift up a couple of scriptures as we make our way into teaching today, just to highlight the importance of our ways and our habits. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 7, I frequently mention it, and it says that when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes his enemies at peace with him. When a man ways, a man or a woman, when an individual, when their ways please God, God then does something. God makes their enemies at peace with them. What makes God to move in such a manner to where God will make a person's enemies have peace with them? Well, it's our ways. And when we look at this word ways, well, what do you mean? Ways deal with the total composite of a being, of our being. Number one, a heart that's pointed towards God and focused towards God. But it's in totality, all of our ways, our thoughts, our actions, our dealings, the things that we do, when our ways please God, God will make our enemies at peace with us. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 19 in the NIV. Watch what it says. It says, great are your purposes and mighty are your deeds. Your eyes, watch this, are open to all the ways of men. Your eyes are open to all the ways of men. You reward everyone according to his conduct and as his deeds deserve. To give everyone according to his ways. Note, if you will, God is just. He does not practice injustice in dealing with us. And I'm so grateful that God is not like man, because when humans deal with you, sometimes they can deal in injustice. But God is not like that. God does not deal with injustice. God is equitable. God is fair. That no one can complain. No one can honestly complain about God's dealings with man. And so watch this, our ways that God gives according to our ways, according to our ways. Watch this. I want you to understand that our ways, our habits are important, that what we do ultimately shows and impacts who we are. What we do flows out of who we are. We do what we do because we are who we are, you know. And so what we do, it flows out of who we are. So watch this. Since what we do flows out of who we are, watch what Hebrews 6, 10 through 12 says. God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you've shown him as you've helped this people and continue to help them. Verse 11, we want each of you to show this same diligence to the very end in order to make your hope sure. Verse 12, one of my favorite verses in the entire Bible, Hebrews 6 and 12. The NIV says, we do not want you to become lazy. King James Version says slothful. We do not want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who watch this, through faith and patience, inherit the promise. Watch this. We do not want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised. The writer's desire for people is expressed in his petitions, watch this, regarding their conduct and faith. Several things about this very quickly, verse 11 and 12. Watch this. He shows a petition about their faithfulness. We're talking about our ways. He chose a petition about their faithfulness. We desire that every one of you show the same diligence to full assurance of hope unto the end. This petition says that the writer, watch this, who I believe to be Paul, wants them to be faithful to the end, wants them to be faithful in the faith. He talks about the petition of the petition about faithfulness, but then the petition about fervency. He says that ye be not slothful. Sloth, hear this, is the opposite of fervency. Slothfulness in life and slothfulness in the faith, particularly, watch this, means disinterest in the faith and lack of dedication in service. There are churches today that are filled with these kind of members that are slothful in their ways, that are slothful in their dealings. But the writer of Hebrews encourages them, as we're encouraging each other on today, that we not be slothful. That God is interested with our ways. That if we're going to recover, our ways have to be different. Our habits have to be different. That we can't be disinterested when it comes to the things of God, when it comes to the Word of God. That, you know, that we put all of our energy and efforts into secular things, into other things. And I'm all for it. Can't make all you can. Help me, God. Ball till you fall. Get all the degrees that you want to get. Whatever your heart desires to do, do it. Do it. Hallelujah. But in all you're getting, in all you're doing, in all you're getting, please get an understanding by keeping Christ first. Matthew 6, 33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. The petition about following. He says, be followers of them. I'm in verse 12, who through faith and patience inherit the promises. This word followers means imitators. He says, be followers of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises, our ways. God is concerned about our habits. God is concerned about our ways. Listen at this. Proverbs 24 is very interesting. You're familiar with it. Proverbs 24, verse 30 through 34. Watch what it says. We're talking about our ways, talking about our habits, amending our ways and creating good habits. Because for some of us, we don't have a money problem. We got a habit problem. For some of us, we don't, lack of motivation has become our MO, has become our habit. And so here, this Proverbs 24, verse 30 through 34, watch what it says. It says, I went past the field of a sluggard, past the vineyard of the man who lacks judgment. Watch what 31 says. Thorns had come up everywhere. The ground was covered with weeds, and the stone wall was in ruins. Verse 32, I applied my heart to what I observed, and I learned a lesson from what I saw. Watch this. Well, look at the writer of Proverbs says, he went past the field of a sluggard, past the vineyard of a man who lacks judgment. Thorns had come up everywhere. The ground was covered with weeds, and the stone wall was in ruins. Verse 32, he says, I applied my heart to what I observed and learned a lesson from what I saw. Verse 33, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like a bandit, and scarcity like an armed man. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like, watch this, a bandit, and scarcity like an armed man. Our habits, our ways, our habits, the little things over time, atomic habits. In chapter 3, Edward Thorndike, a man who has laid the foundation of how habits are formed, was mostly interested in studying animals. He placed cats in cages, and as a part of his experiment, these cats could escape by following a simple step like pulling a lever. And they did, after struggling around for some time. The cats, hence, after some time, associated the pressing of the lever with escaping it. Hear this. Because they associated the pressing of the lever with escaping, it soon became a habitual an automatic response. But these cats didn't get there overnight. Watch this. After 20 to 30 trials, the behavior became automatic. After 20 to 30 trials, the behavior came so automatic until the cats, hear this, could escape this entrapment, could escape this maze within seconds. Now, originally, Thorndike, he noted a cat, and he named this cat number 12. And so cat 12, it took him or her or it initially 160 seconds. But after making attempt after attempt after attempt and doing it over and over and over again, the escape that took 160 seconds, the best time for it and the most consistent time was 7 seconds. So this cat went from 160 seconds to a consistent time of 7 seconds. Thorndike, hear this, he hence concluded that any behavior that leads to positive consequences are likely to be repeated. From this study, Thorndike described, hear this, the process of stating behaviors followed by satisfying consequences. Here's what he argues. He argues, hear this, that consequences tend to be repeated, and those that produce unpleasant consequences are less likely to be repeated. That satisfying consequences are repeated, and those that produce unpleasant consequences are not, watch this, likely to be repeated. This would really, in all intents and purposes, shows us how habits are formed. Because what a habit is a behavior that has been repeated so many times until essentially it becomes automatic. It's been done so many times until it becomes automatic. That's what a habit is. It's been done so many times till it becomes automatic. Watch this. And these habits, watch this, watch what they do. They decrease mental load. They decrease mental load. What they do is because it's a habit, it takes thinking out of the equation. That one of the things that coaches try to teach athletes is they try to put them in a position to where they give them repetition after repetition after repetition, to where instinctively they can do it habitually and muscle memory kicks in and there's no need to think and just instincts just take over and they can just act instinctively. And so then, watch this, this shows us then how habits create freedom. Habits create a sense of freedom that when you can instinctively move, when you can instinctively act, when you can instinctively go forth, that these habits give you a sense of freedom in your life. I'll use myself for an example. I'll give you a part of my morning routine. Every morning I get up as when I realize that I'm conscious, I say some words to the Lord, give God some thanks, pray for my particular day and just pray for our church and those that are connected to me and my family and my friends. And at that point, I'm up. And as I get up, instinctively, the first thing that I do after getting up is I walk directly to the kitchen, to the Keurig in the kitchen, and I make a cup of coffee every morning. So every morning, like clockwork, without thinking, I don't even have to think about that instinctively. I get up and I go after I'm done with my prayers. I get up and I go to the coffee maker and I have a cup of coffee. Black, of course. Amen, somebody. You thought you caught me slipping. Black, of course. Hallelujah. We on black coffee, not cream, not sugar. Black. Hallelujah. And so each morning I have a cup of coffee. I go and what that does is it allows me, watch this, to think. It gives me some freedom. I don't have to think about what I'm doing next. I know when I get up, I'm praying, I'm saying my prayers. And after I do that, I'm going to make a cup of coffee. And that's what habits do for us. Habits give us a sense of freedom. Habits give us a sense of freedom that we're able to move freely. We know what we're doing. We know when we're doing it. We know how we're doing it. We know why we're doing it. That habits, ultimately, they give us a sense of freedom. So very quickly, I want to show you how habits work. Habits work, watch this, in three ways. It's a simple process. And we're talking about habits because when we understand how habits work, then we can understand how to better manage our habits. When you understand how something works, then you can understand, help me God, how to manage what you're working with. It's hard to manage something that you don't understand. Are you with me? So it's hard to, and we're taking this time to deal with habits because we need to understand them. It's hard to create habits, and it's hard to manage habits, and it's hard to examine habits if you don't understand these things. So watch this. Developing habits require a simple process. There are cues, there are cravings, there's responses, and then ultimately there's reward. Cues, watch this, are things that trigger the brain. Cues are things that trigger the brain. Cravings, watch this, act as the motivational force behind your habits. Responses are the actual habits that we perform that leads to the reward. And the reward ultimately is the end goal. Watch this. Cues trigger the brain. Cravings that acts as a motivational force behind your habits. Responses, the actual habits that we perform that leads to reward, and then ultimately the reward, which is the end of your goal or the end of your, watch this, end goal of your habits. So hear this, the cue has to do with noticing. That you notice it, that you notice something. That, for instance, I love coffee, black coffee. And if I'm walking by and I smell coffee because I love it, that does something for me. That's a cue. That's a cue. It triggers something in my brain, that coffee, the smell of it, a freshly brewed coffee, it does something. It triggers, makes a trigger in the brain. However, everybody has different triggers because somebody, you may think coffee is utterly disgusting and you don't drink it at all and it may not do absolutely anything for you. But however, for me, coffee then is a trigger. It's a trigger. And it has triggered me. I've noticed it. And now, because I've noticed it, now, here it is, I am now craving it. Craving is synonymous with wanting it. The cue is I've noticed it. The craving now has me wanting it. And so then my response is, watch this, to obtain it. All right, are you with me? The cue allows me to notice it. The craving allows me to want it. And the response allows me to obtain it. Are you with me on today? When you look at these four things of cues, craving, and response, you know, they do two things. Number one, they satisfy us. Not only do they satisfy us, but secondly, they teach us. They satisfy us and they teach us. And you can break this whole thing down of cues, of cravings, of response, of reward. You can break it down into two sections. You can break it down into the problem phase, and you can break it down into the solution phase. Hear this. So in the problem phase, the cue is there's a text message on your phone. You got a text on your phone. That's the cue. I got a text on my phone. The object lesson here. That's the cue. I got a text on my phone. And because I have this text on my phone, my craving is I want to see who this is that is texting me. The cue is I noticed, right, that I have a text on my phone. And the craving is, I want to see who this is texting me. The response is, watch this, hear this. The response is, I'm going to pick up the phone. And as I pick up the phone, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put in my passcode or facial recognition or whatever the case may be. And then what I'm going to do, watch this, I'm going to read what the text says. I'm going to pick up my phone And I'm going to read what the text says. And the reward is, watch this, I satisfied my desire to read the message. Are you with me today? It's very simple. It's at the outset, it seems complex, but it is very simple in that we all go through this process. The cue basically is noticing. The craving basically is wanting. The response is basically obtaining. What do I do to obtain it? What do I do to go after it? And the reward is having that which I've noticed, which I've wanted, and which I've worked to obtain. Are you with me? So then the question is, now that we have this notion of how habits are formed, let's deal with how to create a good habit, that these things are there when habits are formed. These four things are there. And so we're going to look at these four things. Are you with me? And we're going to, from looking at these four things, we're going to determine how to create a good habit. We're going to look at these four things, and then we're going to determine how to create a good habit. The four are that you have the cue, what I notice. You have the craving, what I want. You have the response, what I'm obtaining. And then you ultimately have the reward. Are you with me? So how to create a good habit? We're almost done tonight. How to create a good habit? All right. So if you're going to create a good habit, number one, you have to make things obvious in your life. It has to be obvious. It has to be noticeable. It has to be obvious. And then watch this. If you're going to create a habit, you got to make it attractive. Then the third thing is you have to make it, watch this, easy for yourself. You got to make it easy for yourself. And then you have to make the reward as satisfying as possible. So let's unpack this in a real sense. How do I make it obvious? How do I make it obvious? If I'm trying to create a habit, let's say I'm trying to create a habit. If I'm trying to create a habit, let's say I'm going to want to get in shape. I want to start exercising and get in shape. So let's say if I'm going to use that, so I'm going to make it obvious. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to share with you, I am going to get in shape. I'm making it obvious. I'm letting other people know. I'm making it obvious that I'm going to get in shape. We're talking about our ways, and I'm going to make it obvious. I'm going to let other people know that I'm going to get in shape. I'm making it obvious. But then, watch this, after making it obvious, I got to make it attractive. I got to make it attractive. I have to make myself want to do it. So then what do I need to do? I need to find out a place that I can work out at that's tailored to me, a place that I can work out at where I like the vibe, where I like the trainer, where the people that go there are cool, they're motivating. I need to find a place, something that attracts me, that makes me want to do it, right? And then, watch this, I got to make it easy for myself. I have to make it easy. So, for instance, I can't make the gym where I'm going, the place where I'm going, I can't make it be an hour and 30 minutes from where I live. Because in Metro Atlanta, an hour and 30 minutes on top of traffic, and it easily turned into 2 hours plus. So you have to make it easy for yourself, because if you don't make it easy, watch this, you'll ultimately fall and you'll ultimately falter. Here it is. Then you have to make it as satisfying as possible. You got to make it as satisfying as possible. Come on, we're on the fast. We're fasting now. So watch this. Let's use this same scenario of creating good habits for our fast. Are you with me? So let's use this same scenario. So we got to make it obvious. We're making it obvious. Everybody knows what fasting is. It's our corporate fast. This is what we do as a family at this time of year during the Lent season. We go on a corporate fast. We started on Ash Wednesday and we ended on Good Friday. That is what we do as a family. We go on a corporate fast. So we've made it obvious. We've put flyers out. You told your friends, you told your girlfriend at work, you told your homie, look, man, I'm on a fast. I can't indulge with you. I can't help me, God. I can't, you know, go to Popeyes or whatever the case may be. I can't do that because we're fasting. We're on a Lent. We're giving up stuff. And so I can't fast with you. So you've made it obvious. But now that you've made it obvious, watch this. Here it is. You have to, I'm helping you on your fast. You have to, watch this, make it attractive. You got to make it attractive. So now, watch this. You got to find things that you don't mind eating instead of things that you would normally eat. You got to find things that you now don't mind eating in lieu of things that you would normally eat. Yes, you want to try the new flounder sandwich from Popeyes, but in this season, the flounder sandwich, because it's fried, help me God, is not in order. So then now what you have to do is you have to find things that are attractive to you that will substitute for the flounder sandwich. You can do things that are vegan, things that are from the earth. So you find things that are vegan. You find things that are from the earth, and you make those things work for you. You make it attractive. But then, watch this, you got to make it easy for yourself. We're talking about fast. I'm helping you stay accountable. You got to make it easy for yourself. How am I going to make it easy for myself? I'm going to make it easy for myself by making food, by making things accountable to me, by making things accessible, rather, to me. So then, therefore, it may require me to meal prep at night, or it may require me to grab some extra fruit in the morning. It may require me to grab a couple of bottles of water and a grapefruit or something on my way out. So I have to make it, watch this, easy for myself. And then the reward is going to be satisfying, because God is going to allow you to become closer to Him. God is going to allow you to, watch this, have access to things that you did not have access to, because you're going to have more power now because you got better proximity. And you know that there's power in your proximity as it relates to God. The closer we are to God, the stronger we are in life. Come on, can we talk? The closer we are to God, the stronger we are in life. You know, when you're close to God, when you walk in with God, you can get some news, some bad news, and you could be like, okay, Well, we'll trust God. You know, we'll continue to pray. But when you're not close to God, when your proximity is off, help me God, you can get some minute news, some minor stuff. You'll have a stress attack. You'll have a panic attack. You'll go into anxiety mode. Watch this, because you're not close to the Father. The closer to the Father that we are, the more strength that we have in life. How to create a good habit. We create good habits, watch this, by making it obvious. We're going to make it obvious. We create a good habit by making it attractive to us. We create a good habit, watch this, by making it easy for us. And we create the good habit by making the reward as satisfying as possible. That's how to create a good habit. Now, hear this. Stay with me. If making it obvious creates a good habit, if making it attractive is creating a good habit, if making it easy speaks to a good habit, is making it as rewarding as possible creates a good habit, then if I inverse this, if I reverse this, and if I do the reverse, then that will help me break a bad habit. Amen, somebody. Amen. It'll help me break some bad habits. God is concerned with our habit. God is concerned with our conduct. God is concerned with our stewardship. How are we stewarding what God has given charge to us? Are we being lazy to it? Are we like that servant in Matthew 25 who the master showed up and called a wicked and lazy servant? Help me, God, because God is interested in stewardship. He's interested with how we manage what we've been given. Would you do me a favor? Would you type in the comments and say, my moments matter? My moments matter. Number one, my moments matter because they're my moments. These are the moments that I have, that you have. When I say I'm speaking in terms of you, these are the moments that I have for life. These are the moments that I have been given, that I'll only get one life to live. And so since we have one life to live, the moments that God has given me, these moments matter. My moments matter. And watch this. Our moments matter. And God, watch this, is concerned with what you do with the time that I have given you. Watch this. We read it. We read it in Proverbs. Proverbs says, I went past the field of a sluggard, past the vineyard of a man who lacks judgment. Thorns were up everywhere. Stuff is not well kept. The ground is covered with weeds. He's doing nothing. He says the stone wall is in ruins. Watch what he says. He says, I applied this to my heart. What I observed, I learned a lesson from what I saw. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like, watch this, a bandit. And then hear this, and scarcity like an armed man. Our moments matter. Our moments matter. Don't you believe that lie of the enemy? Don't you believe that lie of the devil to think our moments matter? One of the mistakes that we make is that we think that we have time. I'll share this with you. One of my good friends, I played high school with him, played college football with him, and the last time I saw him was at the airport. I was going out to Texas for arena football, and he was flying back to North Carolina where he lived, and we saw each other at the airport, and we embraced, and it was a great time. It was love there, nothing but love there. We embraced, and we were both going into the airport, in Tallahassee Airport. We were going into, and we said, I'll see you on the inside. I'll get with you on the inside. We'll hook up on the inside when we get in there. While we're waiting on our plane, we'll hook up, and then we'll catch up. However, we go in, and we do our own thing. I didn't reach out to him. He didn't reach out to me. Me knowing him, how I knew him, we felt like that we had time. Is that even I don't catch him this time, I'll catch him the next time. However, that was the last time I saw him. So one of the mistakes that we make is that we feel that we have time. But God is telling me to tell you to maximize the moments. Maximize the moments. Maximize them. Maximize them. So hear this. How do we break a habit? So we know how to create a habit. We create a habit by making it obvious in our life. We create a habit by making it attractive. We create a habit by making it easy. And we create a habit by making the reward satisfying. So how do we break a bad habit? And all of us are prone to bad habits. We just have them. It's just as life is, we just have bad habits, and we're prone to them because we're human. So here it is. We invert the cue. Watch this. If we're going to break a bad habit, we make it invisible. Are you with me? If we're going to break a bad habit, we make it unattractive. If we're going to break a bad habit, we make it difficult to achieve. If we're going to break a bad habit, we make it highly unsatisfying. So, for instance, if we're going to break a bad habit, let's say you're a shopaholic. I like shopping. Hallelujah. But let's say if you have a problem, your closet is stacked. I mean, with shoes, it's stacked. With clothes, your closet is stacked with shoes, it's stacked with clothes. And let's say you have a problem and you are a shopaholic. Yeah, you're ashamed to say, ashamedly, you are a closet shopaholic. And it's stacked with stuff. And so if you're going to stop shopping, what you got to do is you got to make it invisible. You can't place yourself in that area. You can't even go to the mall. Yeah, because if you go to the mall in this season, because you're vulnerable, you're going to buy something because you got a problem. You're a shopaholic. You like shopping. You like shoes. You know, it's a deal. Everything is a deal to you. And so you can't go. You can't even go. You're going to have to abstain from that. You can't go. You're going to have to make it invisible. And you're going to have to make it unattractive. You're going to have to make it unattractive. You're going to have to say things like, look, I can't go shopping because I'm not going shopping in this season. I can't go shopping because I spent too much money shopping. You're making it unattractive. I can't go shopping because I don't have anywhere to put anything else. I'm not going to go shopping. I'm not going to go shopping because I already have enough as it is. Are you with me today? But then you make it difficult to achieve. You put yourself in a place where you don't have easy access to it. You don't have easy access to it. And then here it is. You make it highly unsatisfying. You make it highly unsatisfying. That's how we break a habit. We break a habit by making it invisible, by make out of sight, out of mind. by making it unattractive. What you used to crave for, it no longer turns you on. You no longer crave for it. You no longer want it. Instead of it being having easy access, it's now difficult and it's now hard to achieve. You can't get there as easily as you once did. It's not as accessible as it once was. And then you make it highly unsatisfying. Instead of getting a high over it, now you think about, okay, what is this going to do to my budget? What is this going to do to my goals? What is this going to do to the promise that I've made to myself with myself that I was going to exact discipline and I was going to do better? Hallelujah. So for our introspective workplace, and then we'll call it a night, our introspective workplace, we only have two, there's two and then we're through. So the introspective workplace, just for you to think over this, the stages which habits proceed are A, response, craving, cue, reward, or B, reward, cue, craving, response, C, cue, craving, response, reward, D, craving, cue, response, reward. All right. Question that we have is open-ended. It says, what habits are you interested in developing? What habits are you interested in developing? And you know how you develop them. You develop them by making it obvious. You develop them by, watch this, by making it attractive. You develop them, watch this, by making it easy for yourself. And you develop them by making the reward. If one of these things are off, It won't become a habit. If you are making it obvious and if you're making it attractive, but here it is, you can't. It's not easily accessible. It's not going to become a habit. If it's easily accessible, but it's not attractive, it's not attractive to you. You're going to become bored with it. If it's obvious to you, if it's attractive to you, if it's easy for you, but it's not highly satisfying to you, it's going to do nothing for you. But for in order to make new habits in your life, you have to rearrange the habit so much so to it's obvious in your life, it's attractive in your life, it's accessible in your life, and it's highly satisfying for your life. Well, I pray that you are blessed on tonight. This is chapter 3 of Atomic Habits. And we're working because we're recovering. We want to be better people. And I believe that when we address our ways, when we address our habits, when we begin to deal with self, in that dealing with self, God is going to show us things. And God is going to give us fresh revelation and new ideas and new energy and new vigor about life. Come on, let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you now for this time. We thank you. Our eyes have seen, our ears have heard. We pray now that this word will be a fresh word, that it will fall on the fertile grounds of the hearts of the listeners, those that are listening now and those that will. God, it will be a relevant and timely word, impactful to their lives in this season, that can be a blessing to them as well as those that they're connected to. God, we love you and we thank you for this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we want to open the doors of the church to you. I want to, at this time, offer Christ to you. If you're out of the ark of safety, if you don't have a church home, if you don't know Jesus and the free pardon of your sin, we want to offer Christ to you even now. Listen, if you want to become a part of our church, we would love to have you as a member. You can inbox us. You can comment below. You can call the church. We have persons that would love to pray with you and for you. And assimilate you to our ministry. Well, there's no worship experience complete without the presentation of a gift. So to that end, we set aside this time now for you to give back a portion of that what God has given to you. Know that God loves a cheerful giver. God loves somebody who gives with a hilarious heart, not grudgingly. And there are promises to those that give that God will open up a window. Pour out a blessing that you don't have room enough to receive. So come on, as you're grabbing that offering, I want to help you attach an expectation to it on tonight. Father, we thank you for these that are giving. We pray now, God, that you withhold no good thing from them. We pray now, God, that this seed will break the poverty, demon of poverty in their life, the demon of check to check in their life, God, and will release favor, God, financially, God, and in every area of their life. So, God, we love you. We thank you for these that are giving. Pray that you'll bless them and keep them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, God bless you, family. Thank you so much for joining us on this Wednesday. I pray that you're staying strong with your fast. Hang in there. Find accountability partner. Listen, if you've fallen down, get back up. Dust yourself back off. Talk to God about it. Get back in the race. God, it is God's desire that you hang in there and that you finish. And listen, if you didn't start with us, hey, even if you didn't start with us, you can jump in right in with us and check out those prayer focuses that we have. And know that every day that we're getting 1% better as we crucify our flesh in the form of turning down our plate. Ultimately, it's allowing us to be closer to the Father. And when we're closer to the Father, we know that there's power in our proximity. Well, I look forward to seeing you on this Sunday. I'm excited about this Sunday, excited about the worship, excited about the word. It's our time to recover. And so I look forward to seeing you on this Sunday. I pray that you would share our broadcast with somebody and that you would, in fact, tell them the great things that are going on at your church. Well, stay in faith, beloved. God has great things in store for you. God is well pleased. God loves you. God honors you, and God is smiling upon you and your family even now. Come on, let's receive our final prayer and benediction. Father, we love you. We thank you, God, for all things. Thank you now for our time. Thank you now for this moment. Thank you now for your presence. Thank you for your power. Pray now, God, that as we embark on fasting, that we would enjoy the process, that each day, God, as we crucify the flesh, giving up, God, food and turning down our plate and whatever else we decide to do, we pray that it will draw us closer to you and that our ways will be pleasing with you, God, and that our enemies will have peace with us. So, God, we love you and we thank you, God. We pray that every good thing that comes to our minds shall come to pass, and everything that our hand touch shall be blessed. Withhold no good thing from us, God. Keep us and cover us, God. Order our steps, God. Favor in our footsteps and our future and even over our foes. We love you. We bless your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, family. Thank you for joining us on tonight. Stay strong. Happy fasting. God loves you. He's well pleased with you.